be seated. I felt I needed to dance up the aisle rather than walk rather solemnly. I did give one little skip step in the middle there, but thank you for that wonderful entry. So welcome to St. Bartholomew's Church on this beautiful spring day. We are here today to say our goodbyes and to remember Chris. His smile, his laughter, his joy, his love. To celebrate his life and to be with the family and friends in their sadness and grief. We meet in the name of Jesus Christ, who loves us, gave his life for us, and was raised to the glory of God the Father. Peace be with you. Let us pray. God of all consolation, your Son, Jesus Christ, was moved to tears at the grave of Lazarus, his friend. Look with compassion on your children in their loss. Give to troubled hearts the light of hope, and strengthen in us the gift of faith in Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Please stand for our first hymn, O Lord my God.
Thank you. knows how much I care. Feel no sorrow in a smile that he is not here to share. You cannot grieve forever. He would not want you to. He'd hope that you could carry on the way you always do. So talk about the good times and the way you show you cared, the days you spent together, all happiness you shared. Let memories surround you, a word someone may say will suddenly recapture a time, an hour, a day. That brings him back as clearly as though he were still here and fill you with the feeling that he is always near. For if you keep those memories, you will never be apart, and Chris will live forever, locked safely in your heart.
Thank you.
someone dies, we have to come to terms with loss. In the first instance, with the loss of the physical. No longer is there a bodily presence of the person we love. We can no longer touch and be touched. We can no longer hold and be held. We can no longer hear the voice of the one we love. But love is more than the physical. Love is beyond what we can see and touch or hear or even understand. And the lovely song about love we just heard says it all. And I believe that all love comes from God. In John's first letter in the New Testament, we read, God is love, and those who live in love live in God, and God lives in them. There is no distinction in my mind between God and love. Love covers the miles. If someone you love is far away and you haven't heard from them for some time, you don't stop loving them. And love transcends time and death. We do not stop loving because we cannot see or hear or touch. And love is why we're here today. There are so many of you here, I'm not quite sure how many, but there are a lot of people in church today, which says today there is an abundance of love for Christopher and his family. The love of God, the love we have for each other, and the love we have for Chris. Now Patrick is going to come and say a few words about Chris, followed by Ben and Charlotte.
It's wonderful to see so many of Chris's friends and relations here to remember and share the joy of the man we knew. His sense of fun, his humour, goodwill, generosity, his thoughtful kindness, not only at obvious occasions, but also at last other less evident times, which showed that he was thinking of us. I think many of us have been touched by that. My earliest memories of Chris are from when I was 4 or 5. He's 12 years older than me, which isn't much when you're in your 50s or 60s, but when you're 8 and the other person is 20, that is a big difference. Most 20-year-olds would at best ignore that. And quite probably despised my year-old younger brother, but not Chris. He was always very kind to me, despite the age difference, would try and involve me as much as possible in his social life. This will explain why, from the age of 13, I was to be found outside the pubs, working hard on developing a tolerance for beer, an endeavour which was wholly successful. His humour was one of his most attractive traits. I remember one Sunday going to church. I must only have been about 5 or 6. My father and mother were in front and Chris and I were in the back. Suddenly a smart car swept in front of us at a roundabout. And Chris called out, "Oh look, there's Jesus in his chair." It was a Spanish acquaintance of his who caught it. We always kept an eye out for Jesus in his chair after that. We never spotted him. Until I was 16, we lived at Killingfield, just down the road from here. And shortly after arriving in about 1955, he joined Haslemere Rugby Club, where he met and made many of his greatest friends. People such as Jeremy Walker, Barry Whitaker, David Power, Mike Manley, who's here today and read one of the lessons earlier, Robin Widows, Tim Seck, and many others who remain friends for the whole of his life. Some of them sadly no longer with us, but others here today. I was too young. We want to page 15. Too young myself, but when I went to school, we acted as lions fairly often, which I enjoyed greatly. I seem to remember in those days, Haslemere didn't actually win rugby games, but they always won the drink. As Ben has said, I thought Ben was coming before. Anyway, the ukulele was a constant throughout his life. He called it a ukulele, it was actually a friend. He started to learn the ukulele while at school. He was educated by Jesuits, and I think his favourite song at the time was I'm behind the prison wall. Ben and Charlotte, you may think you had it tough, but when I was at Chillingfold as a young boy, he started to learn the trumpet. So that was hard. When he was 18, he had to go and do his national service. Like our elder brother Jeremy, he opted for the tank division, thinking being that in the tank division you went to war sitting down. Not this nasty walk. After national service, he had several jobs, some in London and some near to home. And in 1965, he went to Australia, where he remained for about 5 years, returning in 1970. By this time, our father had retired, and the family home moved to the Lake District. In 1972, he started a minibus company called the Mountain Goat in the Lake District. It started with one bus and him driving it. A couple of years later, he had 5 or 6 buses, an office, and a garage. The company ran services and bus tours across the mountain passes all over the place. None of the competition was doing this at the time, as their coaches were too large. In 1975, I passed officer selection for the Royal Air Force, but subject to a final OK from their top medical board, and Chris said, while you're waiting, I can come up and drive a bus, which I did. In the event, the RAF sensibly decided not to risk moving. And I ended up staying with the Mountain Goat for 15 years. Chris's management style was different. Ranged in a spectrum from somewhat disorganised to chaotic. Things did get done and things did work, not always as efficiently as possible. I like to think we complemented each other. Now, the atmosphere at the Goat was, as you would expect, easygoing, but not damagingly so. Humour abounded, we had a lot of laughs. One of the things Chris was particularly good at was dreaming up PR stunts and get free publicity. In 1985, it became apparent during that year we would have carried 100,000 passengers over Hard Knott Pass, the steepest and most torturous pass in England. To mark this, Chris came up with the idea of presenting the person with a live goat. This manager, a lovely lady called Christine, kept goats, and she was persuaded to provide them. We reassured her that we wouldn't really let the person have a goat, as we often on the weekend in the Lake District in the guest house as an utility. The press release duly sent out with the embargo and the details, but it pressed all the right buttons for the local TV and press. On the day, we chose a random lady who was taking the tour with her husband. We were pretty sure they wouldn't want a goat as they lived in an 11th floor flat. The moment arrived, board of TV and BBC looked north of there. The bus stopped on top of the pass and everyone got out to admire the view as they always did. Chris then appeared and told the lady that she was the 100,000th passenger to travel over harbour. We had a little present for her. The goat was led out from behind a rock. The TV crews nearly wet themselves. Dropped, but she was delighted and greatly relieved when told that there was an alternative. This is when, in front of several TV cameras and assorted media, Chris announced that she could either have a weekend in the Lake District with her husband or the goat. Not sure if we had a plan. After sewing up the goat, she's still operational, going from strength to strength under the new owners. I know that is a great source of pleasure. Pride to me. He's semi-retired. The ideas kept coming, one of the most notable being Lord Windermere's nuts, which I'm going to go about later. 18 years ago, Chris and Carol moved to a lovely house on the Isle of Wight, a move which was wholly successful, and which they both loved. It had everything, weather, sea, boats, swimming, and a large garden where Chris could enjoy and grow fruit and veggies. I'm really glad that his last summer, last year, was such a beautiful one. He told me he swam in the sea every day. His last 3 months were not great, but he still retained his sense of humour and was able to raise a smile and enjoy jokes. Carol, Ben and Charlotte were in attendance almost constantly, and I know Carol wants me to particularly thank Ben and Charlotte on her behalf for the incredible support during a period of time when not only was Chris seriously ill, but the house was on, that had been sold on the island needed clearing, and completion of the entire deal was due at the end of it. I'm very thankful, 4 days before he died, to have seen him with all his family, including Carol, Ben, Charlotte, his 2 granddaughters, his son-in-law, Hunt, and even his Labrador, Frankie. Frankie, such a privilege. We were all there together in Chris's not very large room, but at times a number of unpleasant odours manifested themselves. Ben, which Ben was very quick, suspiciously quick, to blame on the dog. He was a special person, someone you don't forget, who brought life and laughter into all our lives, who made us feel better in ourselves. We are hugely lucky to have known him. I'm especially lucky to have had him as a brother. I should just be grateful.
Character is dealing with the occasional, or more than occasional, fault. think there's definitely a reason it took him 43 years to find someone who could match his joie de vivre and also cope with the rest. The perfect match, the same lust for life and the patience of an actual saint. Or in Dad's words, a fire-breathing dragon.
Began as a party in London in 1980 or thereabouts, where for the second time the dedicated bachelor that was Christopher Taylor bumped into the dedicated bachelorette that was Carol Hilton. Dad often warmly recollected picking up the phone to call Mum after their meeting, thinking, oh God, here we go, only to be swiftly told off for Mum having taken so long to call. They never looked back. We had many, many happy years spent in the Lake District, being dragged behind decrepit boats, attached to makeshift surfboards, or unsuccessfully fishing with a branch and a bit of old wire down the pen. Apparently, he once caught a fish like this in the old days. Obviously, he never caught anything, but the quiet time on the lake there was always unbeatable. There was camping, ukulele playing, singing, swimming, and the occasional unsuccessful sailing lesson. Mum and Dad provided the tools for a no-frills, simplistic, and downright beginning. We were taught that materialistic things don't matter, it's the experiences and the people you meet that does. Dad lived this mantra through
Patrick. Being in the lake, he absolutely loved sailing and being around boats. I don't think he's ever actually particularly very good at it, but he loved it all the same. Whatever he did to it. Some of my earliest memories are being on Lake Windermere with Dad sitting in the back of a mirror, his 17-footer, watching very intently and learning everything from him as various swear words came out as we navigated a start line or a mark, normally unsuccessfully. He always told me through that period, well, we've got an old boat, so it's only the newer versions that actually ever have a chance of winning these races. So I was quite surprised some years later when my cousin James, who's here today, actually bought the same boat and consequently won absolutely
everything. Talking of the lakes, we had these wonderful words sent from one of Dad's children to me, just after he died, that sums him up perfectly. I don't really know where to start regarding this. He was the best godfather I've ever seen. I did not meet him until I was about 7, but I'd always heard about this surfing dude that travelled the world. So when I met him at Penny and Jeremy's house, fresh off the plane from Australia, I was not disappointed. He'd come home with a white rabbit skin koala bear just for me. He threw it to me across a little pond, but it didn't make the distance and fell into the smell. It did not stop me loving it for a good 20 years. Actually, the fur wore out and it had no eyes on. He didn't remember birthdays or Christmases, but why would anybody want to do that? Because the times I spent with him were worth so much more than that. In silly gifts and the rest. The summer he took Sarah and I off Mummy's hands when we were not even teens and took us to the lakes for the best summer of our lives, water skiing by day behind some old boat he'd not quite finished building, dragging us around bargaining with him that he was playing to Canada. And we were thrilled to be his groupies. It was just the best time ever.
I think one of the things that we both absolutely love about Dad, one of our favourite things, is probably his imperfections. I think that's what makes him who he is, his messiness, his clumsiness, his ability to never quite finish a job and just make do. He does sound like he's been consistent through his whole life, at least, which is good. I think he's probably up there as being one of the most untidy people around as well. It can easily be seen by looking in about the only area of the house he actually has total control over, which is his workshop. And when you go into the workshop, you'll see a complete bob site, full of tools and sawdust and various number of projects he had on the go. And clearing it out just a few weeks ago, I think I found at least 150 screwdrivers and 50 hammers that he'd lost in various corners of the world this year and just gone on and re-bought. We actually made a fortune off him. And he was also probably one of the most clunky people out there, I think, as well. Not a plate glass or vase was ever safe when Dad was around. In fact, in our house, pretty much all of them never made the cut and have been glued back together in various forms of accuracy.
To start, our boat engine frequently requires smack with a hammer. Our boats always had holes in them. Our cars always broke down. In the early days, this consisted of trips to Cornwall with an inevitable breakdown halfway. Dad walking miles to find the phone and either being towed home or reaching our destination hours later. In recent years, it never seemed to faze Dad that the door of his car opened when he went around a corner. It just slipped out of here every few minutes. He could never find his glasses or his mobile phone. We once found his phone in the fridge. He probably ate and drank too much and he frequently said the wrong thing. I recall being horrified as he innocently offered the pretty girl standing next to him on the tube a seat on his knee. Mum and Dad have always been unbelievably and unwavering in support of the Ben and I, whether deservingly so or not, in whatever we chose to do. This was no more apparent than when Dad came to watch me play hockey for the first time at school. Naturally, he was the loudest supporter on the sidelines and enthusiastically cheered me on the ground. It wasn't until I managed to get to him at half time to say hello that I could inform him that he was in fact cheering for the wrong team. They were never, however, your average holiday, and many years we ventured out to the slopes with some fellow Northern buddies in one of Dad's mountain goat buses, slightly adapted, of course. We would take out the back seats and replace them with numerous mattresses for all the kids to sleep, sit, play, roll around on 20-odd-hour journey village. If only we could travel in such optimal sea days. It was some of these ski trips that I have my absolute best and fondest ukulele-playing memories. Dad frequently, possibly even every night we ate out, would take his view. And Dad frequently, possibly even every night we ate out, managed to get the whole restaurant, whatever nationality, singing along to Fan Like Fan or Cheers. I remember beaming with pride as people sang and gesticulated along to Dad's half made up lyrics. Frankly, most of them could have been in any language, so who knew?
I think when we try and summarise who Dad was, think about his relentless enthusiasm for life. It shows that. And I think enthusiastic is actually a fantastic way to describe him. Enthusiasm and positivity was something that resonated through everything he did. And it also helped him get away with murder. I think enthusiasm is the only way in which I can describe the way Dad took on the challenge of building his own wooden rowing dinghy in the last few years. Now, he's not known for his precision, my father, but all the same, he thought this would be a perfect job for him. As with everything he does, he absolutely loved building that dinghy, and he was very proud of what he created, and quite rightly so. Unfortunately, I think the QE2 was built quicker. And there's also enough fiberglass covering that wooden dinghy that it could also double as a bomb shelter. But the result is something beautiful. A wonky dinghy, full of quirks, built with love for his family to enjoy, and I think it's a perfect reflection of him. His enthusiasm could also be seen in his work. Patrick's talked about the mountain goat, but from what I've heard of his times running the business, he created a place that was a huge amount of fun, and he really looked after all the people that worked for him. After the go, he had a number of projects he threw himself into. One in particular entrepreneur and adventure that Patrick mentioned involved roasting almonds and flavouring them with a secret family recipe. Lord Windermere's Nuts was born. Complete with branding, packaging, and a full backstory of Lord Windermere's and saucy adventures across the world. In reality, Charlotte and I essentially became unpaid factory workers, deep frying and canning tons of almonds in our bar. I don't know how long it actually went on for, but it did seem like forever as a teenager. Unfortunately, Lord Windermere's tales never quite made it to supermarket shelves, but they were delicious, and the family were very grateful benefactors of any leftover stock.
When Dad finished the Mountain Games, he unexpectedly ventured into health insurance. Mum soon joined him and began to realise the numbers weren't adding up, and Dad appeared to have a fairly sizeable sales floor. Firstly, he would get chatting to his potential clients, find out their life story, chat briefly about the insurance, and proceed to tell them that actually he wasn't so invested, and if they looked elsewhere at a certain other broker, they'd be better off. And not telling any sort of lie. Dad was wonderful at many things, but selling health insurance was not one of them, and Mum swiftly and successfully took over. Over the past 10-15 years, he's been involved in Neptune, a fantastic project which I think he has probably told everybody about on numerous occasions. Neptune is a device that generates energy from waves, but despite having no engineering qualifications, it is 100% down to him that that business first started. He encouraged the inventor Dennis Carey to start the business with him in the first place, having met him when he bought a lawnmower a couple of years earlier. The project has been a long one and is still ongoing, but it has been Dad's sheer enthusiasm for it that has kept it from faltering on a number of occasions. We're sad that he didn't get to see it fulfilled, but so far what he's achieved so far.
On the other end of the spectrum, it can only be down to pure enthusiasm that's meant we've listened to the same old jokes over and over and over again. And yet still roll around in laughter at the punchline every single time. I think if there's one thing that you can take from today, it's that you can laugh at your own jokes. Even right to the end of the office, the nurses absolutely loved him, and he was telling the same old jokes, even to them, and he made a big impression. And of course, the ukulele. What on earth can we say about the uke that you don't already know? And I doubt he was the most talented ukulele player there has ever been, but luckily I don't know any others. But I've never known anyone be able to create such entertainment and fun through music, despite playing the same songs every single time and still forgetting half the words. Dinner parties are just not going to be the same without him. All of these characteristics, the good bits, the great bits and the bad, make Dad who he was. And what a wonderful, wonderful man that was.
Some of my happiest days with Dad, in fact, some of the happiest of my life, were when I moved home in my early 20s to set up what became our business. Often in that first summer, Dad and I would bunk off early and take his beloved pub watch out for a whirl, slinging our mackerel lines over the back whilst we cracked open the beer. Pugwash never started the first time, and we were mostly engulfed by diesel fumes, but we felt like kings. We really were living the dream. I always loved and admired how Dad embraced Grandpa, Mum's dad, into our home. It goes without saying that Grandpa's time at Beech Grove was some of his happiest, and that is largely down to the depth of friendship and camaraderie that he built with Dad. Signed and sealed with a shot of Calvados every week. Dad taught Grandpa, who was in his 90s, how to relax, how to enjoy the fine things of life, and how to stay out of this.
And I think Dad leaves behind a fantastic legacy for all of us, a challenge to all of us to prioritise the right things in life, make time for friends and family, talk to people, even if you don't actually know them. Make new friends. Have fun at every moment. Laugh your heart out. Be kind and be generous. And do it all with a load of enthusiasm. And if you make a mess, smash a few plates. absolute certain. He'll have his little ukulele in his hand.
Beyond death, but love survives death, and there is something to look forward to. Chris obviously loved much and has been loved much, and we pray that that love may go on into eternity. I want to end by quoting a short passage from the book of The Bridge of San Luis Rey by Thornton Wilder. It's the very last page. But the love will have been enough. All those impulses of love return to the love that made them. Even the memory is not necessary for love. There is a land for the living and a land for the dead. And the bridge is love, the only survival, the only meaning. Amen.
Time and place, the flood may bear me far.
I hope to see my pilot face to face when I have crossed the line.
Let us pray. God of love, Lord of life, you have made us in your image to reflect your joy and love. We give you thanks for Chris, for the grace and mercy and love he received from you and shared among us. We give thanks for his life and all that he shared with us, and for the memories we treasure today. Hear us as we remember him. We give him back to you and pray that he may be at peace. Bring him and all who rest in your love into the joy of heaven, where sins have been forgiven and death is no more, through the love of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
We pray for Chris's family and friends, remembering especially Carol, Ben and Camilla, Charlotte and Humphrey, Ottilie and Cecilia, the wider family, and all who loved him. O God, who brought us to birth, and in whose arms we die, in our grief and shock, contain and comfort us. Embrace us with your love. Give us hope in our confusion, and grace to let go into new life and new love, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Support us, O Lord, all the day long of this troublous life, until the shades lengthen and the evening comes, the busy world is hushed, the fever of life is over, and our work is done. Then, Lord, in your mercy, grant us safe lodging, a holy rest, and peace at the last, through Christ our Lord. Amen. If you'd like to join with me in the Lord's Prayer, please do. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
Please stand to sing, Praise My Soul, the King of Heaven.
Thank you.
standing as we commend Chris to the mercy of God, our Maker and Redeemer. Chris, go forth upon your journey in the love of God who created you, in the mercy of Jesus Christ who redeemed you, in the power of the Holy Spirit who strengthens you. May angels and archangels come to meet you, the whole company of heaven enfold you in love, and in communion with all the faithful, may you dwell this day in peace. Amen.
Amen.
Rest eternal grant unto him, O Lord, and may light perpetual shine upon him. We have entrusted our brother Chris to God's merciful keeping, and now we commit his body to be cremated. Go now, Chris, go and be one with the winds and the stars and the warmth of the sun. Go in peace, go in love. Go now and be one with the seeds and the trees and the flowers that blossom. Go in peace, go in love. Go now and be one with all that is and with all that will be. Go in peace, go in love. Go now and be carried on the wings of the wind across the water in the boat that you have built. Go in peace, go in love. Go now and be one with God who loves you. Go in peace, go in love. And for those of us who are left, may we go out into the world being strengthened by the memories of joy, of laughter and happiness that we have shared with Chris. Live courageously, for it is the presence of the living God which sustains us now and always. And the blessing of that living God, Creator, Redeemer and Abiding Spirit, be with you and all whom you love this day and always. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.